Stop me if you've heard this before. Global progress is slowly grinding to a halt after a magnificent golden age of innovation. An age where aeroplanes, penicillin, and computers were invented. An age where the greatest minds like Albert Einstein and Charles Darwin changed the way we think about the universe. Progress is getting more difficult, and our greatest minds are focusing on extracting more dollars per click from the latest trivial app. By now, we're supposed to have a base on Mars, flying cars, and robots doing the housework. Meanwhile, vital technologies such as drug discovery are finding breakthroughs increasingly difficult. Are we finally running out of ideas? Are technology advances getting harder and harder? Is innovation slowing down? For this first video in the innovation series, we're going to look at the arguments supporting a slowing of innovation. So let's get started. Back in 1928, Alexander Fleming discovered penicillin's antibacterial properties. It took researchers over a decade to turn this into a medical treatment. But to say this technology transformed medicine is an understatement. Prior to antibiotics, things like childbirth or even a simple cut could lead to death through infection. For this reason, antibiotic medicine is considered one of the most important discoveries of the last century. Fast forward to 2016. A US woman is on holiday in India and breaks her leg. The injury appears to be infected. On return home, the patient presents to a hospital in Nevada. Initial attempts to kill the infection through a standard course of antibiotics failed. When this happens, doctors have a number of antibiotic treatments to fall back on. However, each new attempt to treat the infection didn't work. The hospital had 26 different types of antibiotics available. All of them failed. Unable to treat the infection, the patient eventually died of septic shock. Needless to say, this case sent shockwaves through the medical community. Unfortunately, bacteria strains that are resistant to antibiotics are becoming increasingly prevalent. So we need to develop new drugs to combat this resistance. So no problem, right? Wrong. We face the scary prospect that resistance will get worse as new antibiotics aren't being successfully developed. The last class of new antibiotics was discovered in 1962. We might return to a situation where childbirth, surgery, or minor cuts risk fatal infection. Discovering new drugs is becoming prohibitively expensive as pharmaceutical research and development productivity is actually dropping. It's often said that we've picked the low-hanging fruit and all the remaining options are no longer cost-effective. It's been suggested that this low-hanging fruit hypothesis isn't restricted to drug discovery and in fact applies to technology in general. With that, let's explore the arguments supporting a slowing of innovation, starting with the low-hanging fruit. As technology progresses, we solve the easy problems first and are left with the harder problems, making it exponentially harder to innovate and realize truly revolutionary things. As a result, many new technologies are optimizations, not revolutions. A bit faster, a bit smaller, a bit cheaper, and maybe another feature or two. In fact, some key areas of technology appear to be in regression. 50 years ago, we could send people to the moon. Now we can't. 40 years ago, commercial passengers could fly across the Atlantic in under 3 hours. Now it's over 8. We've commuted to and from work in more or less the same manner for over a century. It's said that even Moore's law, the backbone of our computational progress, is running out of steam. The trend of computers getting faster and cheaper every year appears to be coming to an end as quantum tunneling poses bigger and bigger problems for the shrinking of transistors. But this isn't the only argument for slowing innovation. It's often said that necessity is the mother of invention. When times are good, we rest on our laurels. In the past, we used to have to innovate for our own survival. Now that the developed world is no longer having to worry about where the next meal comes from, there's no need to do the hard, risky work of innovation. And there may be some signs that there's truth to this argument. Few things elicit necessity more than war, and war certainly drives innovation. The list of significant technologies that were created or greatly accelerated during wartime is too long to list in its entirety. Aeroplanes, computers, penicillin, the internet, just to name a few. In fact, the space race was built on the back of national security concerns. In other words, the Cold War put men on the moon decades ahead of what we could have reasonably expected. Now, despite what the news might have you believe, we're actually living through a remarkably peaceful time. If you exclude World War II and just look at the years after it, we can see that battle-related deaths have fallen by a factor of 15. Now out of the shadow of the Cold War, we've seen a corresponding drop in global military spending as a percentage of GDP. That includes the largest military in the world, the United States. In fact, this falling spending has been suggested as a possible reason for slower economic growth. And then there's regulation. Global regulation has grown significantly over the last century. This is either directly mandated by governments or created by the proliferation of regulatory agencies. Take the UK, for example. There are estimated to be around 50 million words in UK law, although no one knows the exact figure for sure. As new laws are implemented, they interact and supersede with existing laws in ways that are difficult for lawyers to interpret, let alone the average person. Yet despite the existing complexity, the UK has doubled the amount of words passed into law since 1950, exacerbating the problem. But the UK is not alone. The US has doubled the amount of federal regulation since 1975. Bringing new ideas to market is extremely challenging, and complex legal regulation makes it even harder, particularly for small innovative businesses that struggle to afford the legal support. But complexity is not the biggest issue. Excessive or out-of-date laws can unintentionally block innovation, either because they failed to see the scope of the technology or didn't anticipate new technologies. Sometimes both. The UK's 1861 Locomotives Act was intended to protect pedestrians and horse carriages from steam engines. It restricted mechanically propelled vehicles to 10 miles per hour on highways and 2 miles per hour through towns. It also stated that they must be manned by two people at all times. In 1865, it doubled down on the regulation, limiting highway speed to 4 miles per hour and mandating three crew with, and I'm not making this up, one person to walk 60 yards ahead with a red flag to warn pedestrians. Quite how you'd miss an extremely big and loud steam engine traveling at walking speed is amusing in and of itself. Though draconian, this regulation did at least make a bit of sense. Steam engines are difficult to operate and aren't quick to change direction or slow down. Unfortunately, this regulation stifled the development of a future mechanically propelled vehicle, the car. You see, once in law, the Locomotives Act essentially blocked adoption and development of the car. Cars were much safer around pedestrians due to their higher mobility and only required one person to operate. Unfortunately, as promising as the car was, no one in their right mind would buy one because of the requirement to have one driver, one person sat in the passenger seat essentially doing nothing, and one person walking 60 yards ahead waving a red flag. But changing laws is a slow process, and most policymakers didn't have any idea what a car was or how valuable it might be. As a result, the Locomotives Act, intended for steam engines, wasn't repealed for over 30 years. It's thought that this regulation alone was responsible for delaying the progress of the car by decades. Though, perhaps worst of all, are regulations designed to protect existing businesses. Take, for example, Tesla's attempts to sell directly to customers online. This is a fairly normal process for most products, but laws designed to protect dealerships have prevented Tesla from selling direct to customers in some US states. And there are many examples of regulations being pushed through to prevent Uber operating in some cities so as to protect taxi companies. While regulation is often necessary and beneficial, there are many who cite complex, excessive, out-of-date, or protectionist regulation as a significant barrier to innovation. There are many more arguments supporting a slowing of innovation that I'm going to address later in this series. Keep in mind though, these arguments aren't always being made by people that don't understand innovation. On the contrary, they include entrepreneur Peter Thiel and economists Tyler Cohen and Robert Gordon. All in all, these problems paint a gloomy picture, a world where we face big global problems and our ability to deal with them continues to erode as future innovations get harder and harder to realise. There's just one problem with this picture though. It's not true. As widespread as this belief is, it appears to hold little resemblance to reality. In fact, the data suggests the exact opposite. The rate of acceleration appears to be accelerating really quickly. But in the face of the intro, how can I possibly say such a thing? We're going to look at the evidence for accelerating innovation in a moment. But first, it's worth trying to understand what innovation is and why measuring the pace of it is harder than it might sound. So, here's the definition of innovation. Turning an idea into a solution that adds value from a customer's perspective. Adding value might mean creating a new product or service that solves a problem. It may be a new business model or a small change in the manufacturing process that translates into lower costs for the customer and thus more value. While this is helpful for our understanding, it's not very useful for measurement purposes. A tiny change in a process could be an innovation, just as the use of penicillin in medicine is an innovation. One small innovation, the other one's big. Does 10 small innovations equal one big innovation? Part of the problem is there's no good metrics for measuring innovation. GDP growth, patents, energy use, processing power, all of these have been suggested as ways to infer innovation. But individually, they leave a lot of room to be skewed by other variables. As a result, there is no definitive measure of innovation. And that allows us to fill a void with whatever criteria comes to mind. In the absence of good metrics, we're left with vague notions of innovation, such as, we haven't had any major breakthroughs like cars recently. Social media is not a big innovation because it makes our lives worse, not better. The problem with these arguments is that they're not well defined either. What constitutes a major breakthrough? If an innovation doesn't appear to make you happier, is it no longer an innovation? How technology affects our well-being is an interesting topic, but it is a topic for another day. Okay, so innovation's hard to measure directly. But if innovation's accelerating, then there should be clear signs of it. Well, there is. If innovation is new value, then looking at changes in industry over time should be a good indicator. If an innovation sparks a new industry, and that industry grows to be a significant percentage of national output, then that innovation is creating new value. So how much has industry changed? In 1900, this was the breakdown of the US economy. Now, let's fast forward to today. 80% of industries that existed in 1900 are small or non-existent today. 67% of new industries didn't exist in 1900. Contrary to our perception of status, new ideas disrupt existing industries or create entirely new industries. And the rate of this disruption is increasing. For most of history, children were likely to have the same jobs as their parents. That started to change around the era of the Industrial Revolution, and it's been speeding up ever since. In fact, this rate of change is getting so extreme that the World Economic Forum highlights that 65% of children in primary school today will end up working in a job that doesn't currently exist, and goes on to suggest that the pace of change is only going to get faster. This is backed up by an observation that a broad class of technologies have been improving at an exponential rate and have been for some time. The most well-known of these is Moore's Law, which we mentioned earlier. Despite what you may have heard, the rapid progress in the speed of computing is not coming to an end. Quite the opposite. Moore's Law is just the tip of the iceberg. Exponential growth
is not just limited to computer chips. But for now, let's just say an exponential increase in technology translates to a corresponding growth in opportunities for innovation. If you're confused or skeptical about that statement, don't worry, there's a whole video coming dedicated to that concept. It's not that the arguments supporting a slowing of innovation are wrong. It's just that there's much bigger factors at play, and we'll take a look at those factors soon. If that's something you want to watch, click the subscribe button and click the bell icon to be notified of when I post it. In fact, these factors translate into such a big effect that Bill Gates was quoted as saying, "I think the idea that innovation is slowing down is one of the stupidest things anyone's ever said." Strong words, Bill. While I wouldn't go that far, as the series progresses, we will see that the forces shaping innovation are massive and don't show any sign of going away soon. But first, what's wrong with the examples that are supposed to support the slowing of innovation? At the start of the video, I was making some fairly depressing statements about the future of some of our key technologies. So with that said, are we really on the edge of an antibiotics apocalypse? Is the era of space exploration over? Are the days of faster and faster computers coming to an end? Let's find out.